Welcome back. AC lesson number 9. No review. Let's go straight to the new information. There's no question about it. In my opinion, the 3 most common problems with automotive air conditionings are leaks, and more leaks. What leaks? Everything. Compressors leak, evaporators leak, condensers leak, connections leak, service fittings leak, gasket seals, O-rings leaks. Everything leaks. So it's very important that we learn how to find leaks. This lesson is refrigerant leak detection. Fancy word is find them freon leaks. There are 6 methods of detection. We'll be able to cover 2 of them today. The first one is called a visual inspection. A professional knows that's always how to start. I don't care what you're trying to fix, a professional is going to do a visual inspection. He knows what to look for, and let me share with you. A visual inspection can find different levels of leaks, and we're going to identify the 3 major levels of leakage that can occur on the refrigeration system. A visual can test many components there. It can be that easy. But, there is limitations, and you have to understand the limitations. Understand, first of all, what is normal for the oil, the refrigeration oil. There it is, refrigeration oil. We know what it's for. It's to lubricate the moving parts of the compressor / engine. Without lubrication, the moving parts would not last. So, I don't care what kind of compressor it is, reciprocating, scroll, vane, 10 cylinders, 2 cylinders, I don't care. All those moving parts need lubrication. Now, the oil does something else besides lubricate the compressor. The oil circulates through the entire refrigeration system. Just like the freon, the oil catches the ride and goes through the entire system. We're talking about normal. Normal is when there's enough oil to lubricate the compressor and it's a big and, lubricate the compressor and circulate through the entire system. The oil is not trapped in the compressor. The design allows the oil to circulate through the entire system. We know the purpose of the oil. What purpose does it have? Well, why do they do that? Why is there oil in the evaporator, in the condenser? Why is there oil in the tubes and the valves and the lines and the hoses? Why is there oil in the accumulator and the dryer? Here's a trick question for you. The oil does blank. Fill in the blank. The oil does nothing. I used to tell the students that, but no. There's many benefits to the oil provided in the evaporator, the valves, the condensers, the hoses. First of all, this oil is a protective coating on all the metal surfaces. Almost all the metal used on air conditioning is aluminum. The evaporator, the condenser, the dryers, accumulators, parts of the line, all of the line, they're all made of aluminum. This coating is like a paint job that protects the metal surface. So it's good to have the oil in these areas. It helps to keep the seals rejuvenated. That means like new, pliable. It helps to lubricate the moving parts in the valve. Yes, there's moving parts in the valve. And yes, any moving part needs lubrication. It helps to keep the rubber hoses pliable. These are the benefits. So it does more than just circulate. It provides us with many benefits. There should be a coating of oil inside the evaporator, condenser, obviously the compressor, the valves should have a film coating of oil on it. All the lines and connections and fittings should have oil in it. Norm. Here I'm indicating the arrows. The arrows are indicating the direction of refrigerant flow through the system. In this particular slide, I want you to think of the arrows as the oil. When we have normal oil, okay, when we have normal oil, there's enough oil to lubricate the compressor and circulate through the entire refrigeration system. Understanding normal, the correct amount of oil, and they all are different, Some use a very small amount, some use a whole bunch amount. What's the difference of size, the size of the refrigeration system? This particular one is probably on a dual unit, on a van or SUV, where it has an AC evaporator in the front and one in the back. This is probably a small car. This is an average size car. Each vehicle is different. They use different amounts, and we'll show you how to find that information. They have different kinds of oil. Oil's a big information. Measuring has become very difficult. To measure the oil in the system has become very difficult. A little trivia here. In the beginning, here we're in the 60s and 70s and a little bit of the 80s, the motor companies used to put what were called isolation valves. You see those guys on top? They still use them at residential and commercial. They have isolation valves. Now the name implies what it does. If we turn the isolation valves a certain direction, they actually had three positions, we would isolate the compressor from the rest of the refrigeration system. We would remove this little plug here, right there. We put a piece of wire down in there and we would measure the level of oil. We always wanted at least half an inch to three quarters of an inch. Now, General Motors had the best idea of all. While the compressor is installed onto the vehicle, all you did was loosen this plug on the side, and if oil came out, you had enough. If oil didn't come out, you didn't have enough. Yes, it's kind of like a differential or a manual transmission. You can actually see the belly of the compressor, and that was full of oil. This was a pretty good way. Today, to check the amount of oil in the compressor has become difficult. How do you do it? Well, first you're going to have to take all the refrigerant out. That means recover. We're going to have to recover the refrigerant in order to remove the compressor. You have to remove the compressor. There's no magic plug that you can put a little wire down in there or just loosen to see if it comes out. You have to take all the refrigerant out. You have to remove the compressor. This compressor looks easy. It's easy to get to. What about this one? Where's the compressor here? Number three? I don't think so. You know where it is. I hope you do. Back to the leak detection. Guess what happens to the oil after a while? The correct amount of oil is going to blank. Decrease. It starts off with, let's say, 8 ounces, and then it's going to leak. Why? Because the refrigerant leaks. And the oil is tagging along with the refrigerant. The Freon leaks, the oils leak. And then rookies, they'll put Freon refrigerant in without putting oil. You're doing a huge injustice if you just add the refrigerant. The oil is very important. Here, I'm indicating normal. You see the arrows. The arrows are indicating the oil. There's oil that is circulating through the entire system. Here, I'm trying to represent. There's little to no oil circulating through the entire system. Why is there no oil circulating through the system? Because it's low on oil. Just like it gets low on refrigerant, it gets low on oil. And we're talking about doing a visual inspection. It should. If you have the correct amount of oil, and you're going to find that I am very generous with the oil. I like to put oil for a bunch of reasons, and one of the reasons I like to put extra oil is it can help me find refrigerant leaks. I put oil in this vehicle, and it's very obvious. It doesn't even use the UV dye, if you know what you're doing. I found this leak. I remember this was in the driveway when I used to repair vehicles in the driveway. Yes, that may be some other fluid, and we'll identify that in just a minute. There's no UV dye here. There's enough oil in the system that it's going to leave a stain. You see a stain here? No, because there's no leak. What about this one? There's no oil stain residue. There's no leak here. Here, let me explain how the clamps work. The clamp is a clamp. You have the metal, you have the rubber, and you have this crimp. These guys leak after a while. This hose has a leak right here. There should be no residue of oil anywhere along here. Over here in this section, right in here, I call it dusty dry. if there was an oil film on here, I'd be suspicious of the hose, suspicious. Here, what's leaking? Well, it's the crimp clamps between the rubber and the metal. It's not rocket science. This is power steering hose. You see the wetness there? There's a leak there. It probably uses the same kind of clamp. Over here on this one, you think there's a leak there? I don't. It's not rocket science, but you have to have the right amount of refrigerant oil if you're going to do this correctly. What do you think here? Is this a suspicious area? No, it's all dusty dry. Hey, what's this thing? I mentioned it once, I better mention it again. It's not unusual for vehicles to have these little tanks, and they can be on the high side and the low side. And no, they're not the drying element, they're mufflers. They muffle the moan of the refrigeration system. Some vehicles have one, some have none, some have two. You think we have a leak here? Of course we do. What about this? This is an AC pressure switch, and because it's on the liquid line, that gives us the high pressure. There it is, high pressure here. Do you see any residue of oil anywhere in the switch? These guys leak, right? Everything leaks. Right here, what do we have leaking? Looks like a condenser. Does it look like a rock hit it? Anywhere, there's a very suspicious area here. No, I don't see any physical damage on the outside, so why is it leaking? It is the internal friction of the refrigerant passing through these that deteriorate it. Let's go on, all right? What did I mention? Condensers leak, compressors leak. There's an O-ring here. I'm gonna take you inside in some future lessons. Evaporators leak. Yes, we have a leak here. Yes, we have a leak here. Now that looks like a new evaporator. And yes, they have the UV dye, but it's got that residue of oil. Why do evaporators leak? And they're terrible nowadays. They're paper thin. These evaporators used to be made to where they would last 30 years. Some of these evaporators on certain motor companies, they don't even last 5 years. They're so thin on the material. There is one component that will require a slightly different technique. You're not going to be able to see the evaporator, but you can do a visual inspection, but you got to know what you're doing. There is a way to look for the oil residue near the evaporator, and let me introduce to you the condensation drain. The condensation drain, all vehicles do have a condensation drain. The purpose of the condensation is for the water to drip out of the evaporator casing onto the floor. You see it? Where is it? There. That's an average looking condensation drain. We're under the hood. You can see it. This is where the water comes out. This is where you would look for a residue of oil. Do you see any oil residue here on the condensation drain? It's a very small piece. But if there's any oil in there, that means the evaporator is leaking. The condensation drain is there for the water to drain out, but it's also there for you to perform a visual inspection. Not all drains are easy to see. There's supposed to be one there, but sometimes they're so difficult that they're covered up. What's this? No, that's not a car. That looks like a commercial. And everything that you're learning about refrigeration system plugs into your house. Here's my liquid line. Inside's the evaporator. Here's my return line called the suction. And yes, there's my condensation drain. One more important thing about the condensation drain. This is where you sometimes have to use shop air to blow into it. Well, why would you do this? Because the carpet on the passenger side is wet. The carpet can get wet for two reasons. Yes, you can have the condensation of the air conditioning dripping onto the passenger compartment. And you can also have antifreeze. We'll explain that one later. The heater core is leaking. Why is the carpet wet? Because the drain is clogged up. I'm the why guy. Well, why did it get clogged up? Well, they got dirty. Dirty of what? They got dirty of leaves and dirt. This is the beginning of the ventilation system. These leaves are going to deteriorate. And late model vehicles typically do have what is called a cabin filter. And it's important to change and clean these filters because it affects the flow of the blower air. This area should be kept clean. It only takes a few seconds. This is preventive maintenance to make sure that your evaporator drain doesn't get plugged. evaporators can get so dirty, they affect the airflow. It happens on vehicles. This is an example of how it happens onto a house unit, home unit. Now, there are limitations. Let's identify. The visual is simple, it's accurate, but there are limitations. If the system does not have the correct amount of oil, and they barely put enough nowadays to begin with, and you lose a little bit, the visual is going to be very limited. Some components, like the evaporator, cannot be seen, so you have to use a different technique. We mentioned it. It is possible for engine oil, power steering fluid, maybe even transmission fluid to leak onto a compressor or line. Maybe somebody spilled it. This is a limitation. To summarize, the power, do not underestimate it, is a very powerful tool. It can and will find leaks. A visual inspection can, does, and will detect refrigerant leaks. Method number two is called liquid refrigerant detector. Okay, one of a kind, Big Blue. Nearly 80% of HVAC technicians here in America and Canada use it. It can measure almost half an ounce of loss. Here it is. I bought it one time. I went to the HVAC store. It cost about $14. It was about a quart. I usually just go to the Walmart and buy a quart of bubbles. Well, actually, lately, I've been buying it by the gallons, a little more cheaper. Yes, we're talking about kids' bubbles. This is an official HVAC refrigerant leak detector. This is also a leak detector. It doesn't have to be rocket science, but there are limitations. Let's go on. Yes, okay. Wait till you spray your first leak and you say, whoa, there's my leak. But we have to split hairs. We have to split that leak into three main areas. Let's start with the big one. The big leaks, large leaks, they're easy to find. You can even hear them hissing. The bubbles are going to show it. This is a large leak. This is a medium leak. This is a small leak. We're dividing leaks into three major categories: small, medium, and large. Let's go on. Limitations. Works great. The bubbles work great on big leaks. They work good on medium leaks. They don't work so well on the small leaks. You have to understand the limitations of each of the different methods of detecting refrigerant leaks. Here is the routine. AC is not working. Compressor does not engage. The number one reason a compressor does not engage, there can be more than one, but the number one reason is so low, it's not going to engage. You have to have at least 40 PSI, plus or minus a little bit. Each vehicle is a little bit different. If you don't have at least 40 plus PSI, the compressor is not going to engage. No, you're not going to fill it up with refrigerant. There's better ways of doing it. There's two ways to pressurize the AC system. The professional way is to use a nitrogen cylinder. And yes, we're at the college. We have it. And you'll be demonstrated on how to use this. We fill the system up with nitrogen pressure. This is a professional method. The other method, and some folks might disagree with me, is using compressed air. The reason they say you shouldn't be telling them to do that is because when you use compressed air, officially the drying element is now saturated with moisture. There is moisture in the compressed air where there is no moisture in the nitrogen. This is the professional way. I think this is okay. Let me explain why. There's a problem down here. Okay, there's a problem. I need to find a leak for test purposes. That's what I call it. For test purposes, I'm going to use shop air. Sure, that drying element is saturated, but I'm going to figure out what's wrong first, fix it, and then I'm going to put the new drying element in there. We're trying to find a leak. You don't have to put Freon. You don't have to use the nitrogen. You can just use plain old shop air. Let's go on. All right, let's go on. I'm going to show you how to pressurize the system using either shop air and both nitrogen. I'm going to show you how to do this. Lab's coming. We can hardly wait. Now, here's something interesting. You need to limit yourself. No, you don't want it. Look, it says retard. This gauge is calling me retard. No, you don't want to go into there. You want about 100 at about 110. I'm going to show you how to pressurize the system to 100 to 110, and I'm going to call you that if you go over. Okay, so we have 110 pounds, right? I'm going to close the hand wheel. This is an important step. We pressurize the system to 110 pounds. We are basically trapping it in here. We're going to stare at the needle. We're going to wait about 1 minute. We're going to look at the needle. We're going to pay attention to the needle. And if you can see the needle move in 1 minute, if you pay attention, sometimes it has a big leak. If you can see the needle moving, you have category big. It's going to be easy to find that leak. The next category. Next category is you put 100, and 10 minutes later, it barely lost any. If the needle doesn't move or barely moves, barely means like 1 or 1/2 pound. If it doesn't move, guess what size leak you have? You now have a small leak. If the needle moves, it has a big leak. If the needle doesn't move, you have a small leak. Of course you have a leak. Of course you do. The vehicle came in near empty. Now here's how we split the hairs for the medium leak. If you drop 10 PSI more in 10 minutes, I made that up. That's basically a pound a minute. If you lose 1 pound a minute, which means 10 pounds in 10 minutes, you now have a medium leak. What difference does it make? The bubbles works great here. The bubbles works good here. The bubbles usually will not find a small leak. There it is, the official 57 refrigerant leak detector, 100%. Kids' bubbles not diluted. Wait till you spray and see your first bubble. Of course, there's a limitation. Pesky evaporator. I know spraying the condensation drain is not the right way. The bubble has to hit the exact point of leakage. Some connections are hard to get to. They're so hard you can't even see it. Well, you can't even spray it. You cannot test the compressor front shaft seal. This is a compressor front shaft seal, and no, it's not in the very beginning. It's way down inside the neck of the compressor. And sure, these guys leak, but spraying the front of the compressor, expecting it to the bubble, is not going to happen. There's a limitation on the bubble. That seal is way down in the neck. Do not underestimate the power of a bubble. It works. Our next method of detection is the electronic leak detector called the halogen. Sometimes called the sniffer and beeper. There it is. That's going to be our next lesson. Dun, dun.